This is HeadStart FM, supporting the mental well-being and resilience of 10 to 16-year-olds in Wolverhampton.
Hi everyone and welcome to another episode of the HeadStart Podcast. My name is Richard Anderson. As regular listeners to the show will know, in our most recent podcasts, we've been speaking to young people at the Nightingale Centre in Wolverhampton about some of the mental health challenges that they have had to face, the effects that these have had upon them, and how they're working to improve things with support from the Nightingale Centre and from other local sources of support. If you haven't listened to those shows yet, I strongly suggest that you do. I think they contain some really thought-provoking insights from the young people themselves. So listen back and send feedback and comments via @HeadStartFM on Twitter or via the comment form that you'll find at the bottom of the podcast post for each of those shows. This week's show, though, is a little bit different. A couple of Thursdays ago, the team at Aspiring Futures, working alongside one of our community development coordinators, Manjit, they organised a Punjabi language training session for members of the local community in Blakenhall and Parkfields. That's an area of the city where about 20% of residents speak Punjabi. The session was really well attended and gave people who came along really important information about mental health and mental illness, and also what to do and where to go if they were experiencing mental health challenges themselves. It also gave them information about the work that's going on with their children via Head Start in schools and in the local community. During the course of the session, I took the opportunity to record some audio with Manjit and with two of the session leaders from Aspiring Futures, Satwant and Jasmeen. You're going to hear sections from those recordings in this show. You're also going to hear me interject with some additional information based on extra conversations that I had with those three people. I think there's some important information that we need to drop into this conversation that wasn't recorded as part of the recording sessions. So I hope that this doesn't come across as me interrupting the flow of what's being said by our three speakers. As always, you can find the show notes for the podcast on our website. And in this case, the link for that is headstartonline.co.uk/podcast/23.
This is HeadStart FM.
So Aspiring Futures was asked by HeadStart to put in a mental health awareness event for Punjabi-speaking community, especially parents and the elderly, in order to make them aware of the different types of mental health illnesses, the symptoms and ways to tackle them and how to seek further help in terms of mental health.
As a HeadStart community development coordinator, it's my role to ensure that all communities are accessing the Head Start services that we've got available for young people, 10 to 16-year-olds, and parents within their local communities. Within Wolverhampton, it's a very diverse community. Lots of different ethnic groups, lots of different languages spoken, and in particular, we seem to get lots of new arrivals coming all the time. So in order to ensure that those people are accessing those services, it's very important that we reach out to them and we work with them. And sometimes English can be a barrier, language is a barrier for those people accessing those services. So this is why we're piloting our first session in Punjabi for the Punjabi community. It's mental health awareness and Head Start awareness to make parents aware in terms of what services their young people can access around emotional health and wellbeing, but also the lot of services that they can access as parents as well.
People from the Punjabi-speaking community, they do struggle to access services simply because they may be stay at home moms who are not aware of what's going on around them.
This is HeadStart FM.
Just to add to what Satwant is saying here, I think it's important to understand that there's two things at play here. One is that there may be a greater likelihood of a particular mental health challenge in a particular community. The other is that it may be that the way that the people in that community are supported and their access to services to support that might be reduced. And it's important to understand that just because there might be a greater likelihood of a particular mental health issue in a community, it doesn't mean that those issues are entirely caused by cultural, religious, or even, I suppose, genetic factors in those communities. There might be other interactions at play, including racism, issues of accessing support for non-native English speakers, and the fact that maybe poverty can affect some communities in some locations more than others. So we need to be careful. A statistical observation that says people in a particular community are more likely to suffer with, say, depression, doesn't necessarily imply there's something about that community that causes that. That link, that correlation, could also be related to how other parts of our society, health services, education, policing, interactions with other communities, interact with members of, in this case, the Punjabi-speaking community that we're discussing.
There is a general stigma with every community with regards to mental health, which I have come across as a professional. There is this stigma with Punjabi community as well. Punjabi community is normally very well-knit community, like, you know, very family-orientated. And if there are issues, people, the tradition is, or the culture is, normally people will talk within their families, or they will talk to their elders, or they will go to the spiritual healers. And that would be their first port of call rather than going to the professional experts. What we're trying here is trying to break that tradition or that sort of a culture. So we are encouraging people, if there is something wrong, they should go and seek professional advice or medical advice. So the first port of call, we think, should be the general practitioners. So they should go to their GPs and access that sort of services from their GP if they're feeling low, if they're feeling bad, if they're not sleeping well, if they're having low self-esteem. The best thing is to go and speak to their general practitioners.
It is important to support the Punjabi-speaking community in regards to these issues, simply because they are not aware of these things. They might have something which they bring from their own country into this country, for example, stigma, associating any type of mental health illness with madness and black magic. And they bring that into this country, which is not necessarily true, because the victim in the family might be the one who might be going through some mental health illnesses, and all they need is to see a doctor, access those services, and then it could be on the road to wellness, basically.
This is HeadStart FM.
I'm very struck by this observation that the strength of family units in Punjabi-speaking communities, that their closeness can be double-edged when it comes to mental health. There's a strength in unity. Something which can be a real benefit most of the time can also be a problem when someone in the family experiences mental health challenges, pride turning to shame, and a protective shield that's around the family can become a barrier to seeking support. One of the other things that was discussed off the recording is that there's a feeling in Punjabi-speaking communities, and maybe Asian communities more generally, that the way that Western communities view health is not matched to how they view health. I think people with a sort of a Western view of health tend to view the body and mind as quite separate entities, as two separate things. Whereas a more traditional view for Asian communities is that all of the elements of a person, mind, body, and spirit, are unified and could and should be treated holistically. There is evidence to suggest that people from minority ethnic groups in the UK are more likely to disengage from mainstream mental health services. So even if they have approached a GP and begun some form of treatment or some sort of form of therapy, they seem to be more likely to withdraw from that later. And I wonder if these two things are related to each other. So we have a picture in which the ways that health services work with people from some communities aren't adapted to make them more accessible to people who have a different view of health or mental health because of their cultural, ethnic, or religious backgrounds. For some members of the Punjabi-speaking community, especially people who've arrived very recently, there might be, and Satwant has referenced this, work to be done to educate them and support them in moving away from maybe superstitious views that link mental illness to madness or to black magic or to evil spirits. But we do need to balance that with providing access to services that respect different cultural views of mental health and work with members of different communities to improve outcomes as far as possible.
The first thing is, like, you know, lack of acceptance or hiding those kind of symptoms from within themselves. And that is happening a lot within Punjabi community as well. So if they're feeling low, or if they're feeling demotivated, if there are certain changes in their behavior, attitude, they won't first acknowledge that themselves. And I think that
that is something, that is the awareness we are trying to create. We are trying to tell them, like, you know, what does depression looks like? What does depression feel like? How would you behave if you're feeling depressed? Same thing with anxiety, panic, or insomnia, or PTSD. So these kind of disorders, like, how would you feel when you are suffering from PTSD? Or how would you feel when you're suffering from insomnia? And you don't have to suffer alone. You have to go and you have to speak to people who can help you with that.
So there are particular issues surrounding mental health awareness in the Punjabi-speaking community, especially with the women. And that's because if there is somebody in the family who has a particular mental health symptom, even though the Punjabi-speaking the families can be quite close-knit and together, what happens is when they find out that there is a certain issue, they learn because they won't go to anybody else to seek the right kind of medical advice, which is actually quite interesting because as my job as an ESOL, I'm also the counsellor as well as other things. And I do find that some of the ladies come to me on a one-to-one basis and tell me some of these things. And they're coming to me in confidence to speak about these, you know, about the whole shame thing and how they're afraid. And then what my job would be is to support them and make them aware of all the services that are available. They tend to be the first person to blame when something goes wrong in the family. It's like a double-edged sword. They are the core, but then again, they're the first ones to blame if anything goes wrong. So, I mean, these women are, they have to put on a strong image to show that they are a certain image, but then at the same time, they have this vulnerability where they get blamed for absolutely everything, and they're afraid of that. So they might not disclose certain things about mental health issues.
This is HeadStart FM.
Just some supporting evidence for what Satwant has just said. There is evidence that the rate of suicide is higher in young Asian women than is typical, which may reinforce this idea that we have in the Punjabi-speaking community. Some women who are at the core of these family units and are feeling very pressurized by the responsibilities of that, that they are at the center, they're sort of the strong center of those family units, which can be both a benefit, but when things start to turn or when mental health challenges come into play, it can really exaggerate and emphasize those issues. And so we need to provide those avenues by which those women can reach out and access mental health support that's appropriate to them.
Things are changing with awareness, with education, and things are also changing due to social media as well. So people are becoming more informed regarding the words like depression or the words like anxiety and the panic. And that is something people are not generally ashamed to say about those things. But there are certain facts about this, like, you know, if somebody is diagnosed with bipolar or if somebody is diagnosed with some sort of paranoia, that might be something they might not tell to their extended families, that what's happening with regards to that, or they're seeking any help with regards to those illnesses, which could be high risk illnesses, like, you know, if they are having pathological suicidal ideation. That sort of things are still considered quite scary, and people would still go to the spiritual healers to get them fixed. So we are trying to break that behavior.
The good thing I found is that a lot of community leaders and a lot of religious leaders have recognized that mental health is a big issue and a big problem. So they're quite forthcoming and they want to work with Head Start. They're involved in our steering groups, they're involved in our work, and they're quite open for us to go into the local temples, go to the local churches, the local religious groups, the local mosques, and talk about mental health to the congregation and to local residents. So it's very important that service providers and tailor their services to meet the needs of local communities and within local areas, so people can access them, and they should understand what some of the barriers are. So it's two ways. So not only are we working with the residents, the parents, the young people, but we're also working with service providers, you know, so that they understand what some of the barriers are to accessing services as well.
There's stigma associated with mental health issues in all communities, and campaigns such as those from Time to Change and locally Work from Head Start Wolverhampton are aimed at breaking down that stigma. It maybe doesn't need saying, but we do need to remember that every individual is different. And when we're discussing different communities and maybe some of the trends around mental health in those communities, whether positive or negative, those are by definition statistical statements. Ideas and feelings about mental health will differ from person to person and will also vary across generations. Statistics about issues in certain communities of all races, religions, and cultural viewpoints are helpful in informing how services could and should work with those communities. But every individual, every family is also different and needs to be supported in the context of their challenges and their feelings.
This is HeadStart FM.
Huge thanks to Satwant, Jasmeen and Manjit for sharing their thoughts. We're going to finish the show with some audio snippets from a video blog recorded by Aman. Aman is a teenage member of the Punjabi-speaking community and worked alongside the Positive Participation, another organisation working and supporting that community, to create his video blog, sharing some of his thoughts about some of the challenges faced by that community from the perspective of a younger person, from the perspective of a teenager. Huge congratulations to Aman for his video blog. There is a direct link to his video on YouTube contained within the show notes at headstartonline.co.uk/podcast/23. But his thoughts are fascinating. That's it for this week's show. Until next time, goodbye.
This is HeadStart FM.
What's up, guys? My name's Aman, and today I'm going to be talking a little about mental health and the issues that surround it in Punjabi or Indian community, or maybe even the wider community. First of all, what is good mental health? Well, it starts with you. Being confident and happy with yourself and your actions can really benefit your good mental health. If you're happy and confident with yourself, then you stop caring about what people think of you, and you can live your life not worrying about what he's gonna say or what she's gonna say or what he thinks, what she thinks. It's about you. In life, you know, it's all about you. You write your own story, you live your own life. It's not, you know, she comes in and she does this, he does this. No, you live your own life. No one else lives it for you. Also, surrounding yourself with loved ones, friends, family, whoever it is, that can really help your good mental health, because if you're surrounding yourself with people you love, then you're getting support from them, you're having fun with. No one's gonna see it, no one's gonna know about it, so, you know, it's just gonna keep getting worse and worse and worse. It's gonna eat you out from inside until it's too late. So, you know, do not ever bottle up your emotions. If you have concerns, tell someone, talk about it, write it down, you know, do something to get all those emotions out of your system so you can live your life better. Mental health in the Punjabi community, or in the Asian community for that matter, is not talked about. People who are part of this community, they don't tell people about their mental health, what's going on in their mind. They don't ever speak about it. They put on a facade of happiness, so people think, oh, you know, she's happy, he's happy, you know, there's nothing wrong with them, they're fine. But deep down inside, they have all these troubles that they're not telling you about. So, you know, bad mental health in this community is like never, it's really never talked about.
This is HeadStart FM, supporting the mental well-being and resilience of 10 to 16-year-olds in Wolverhampton.